we did some work for this almost billionaire, and he had these problems. I was aware of them, and I said, "Wow, you know, this, it's quite a problem, huh?" And he said, "No, no, 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 no. It's a challenge. It's a great challenge." That's how he looked at it. He relished the challenge of it. So right now, we are in the best of times because we have this tremendous challenge ahead of us. We're under the gun big time. And that brings out the best in us. Instead of feeling self-pity, say, "Hey, what a great opportunity. I have this obstacle that it's challenging me, and I can find a way to get past this obstacle." So right now, I'm putting myself under the gun voluntarily, sort of like a fasting right now, because I have a goal, a certain weight goal to reach by election day, you know. So maybe the day after I will weigh myself and see if I reached it. And I'm pretty close. I still have to lose a few pounds, but you know, only a couple of days away. I'm basically just fasting, not eating anything at this point, and exercising. Start a lot of good habits during October. That was the goal. Stretching regimen, flexibility regimen, some stationary bike work. Started jogging yesterday. Took my first jog in about, what, 4 years, something like that, 3 or 4 years. changed my diet completely. Lost a lot of weight. On and on like this, getting up earlier. A lot of fundamental life habits in October. Started establishing these very, very, very good habits, and now I feel like I'm and vastly have momentum going forward into these times that are to come. And then the goal is to continue the momentum of these habits through up till, you know, into January of 2013, to continue these habits. So at that time, I'll be at you know, peak functioning, of course, from a flexibility, diet, you know, a fitness standpoint. That's just one standpoint. Then also to continue the satsangs from a clarity standpoint, want to be at peak. We want everything to peak, all our time waves, you know, to peak as it comes up here. And this election has been a great expedient, you see. When you're on the path of not returning, not getting a return ticket to disengaging with belief, and therefore not getting a return ticket to standing up to that bully of belief and rejecting its guilt when it tells you that you somehow have to save the world, straighten the world out, or else the whole world will never be straightened out, which is totally untrue. You need to use expedience. Whatever you can find as an expedient, you need to use it. And that's the genius. You have to be a genius on the path. So we have this tremendous expedient, the election. And seeing that coming, you know, I tried to set an example saying, let us use that as an expedient to establish the best life habits we can at this time. So going after that, we will have these habits and be easier to just keep them going. You know, establishing a habit is difficult, very difficult. Like starting on a diet is extremely difficult. Starting an exercise program is extremely difficult. Once you get it rolling, then it's not so hard to keep it rolling. Same with satsang. Starting the habit of satsang is difficult inquiry, but once you get it going, you know, it's not so difficult to keep it going. So if you see these very important expedients coming up, use them to challenge yourself to get it going. So hopefully some of us have done that. And there's still, you know, 2 months left in this year to get it going, to get it going. This election was like to get it going early, which is very helpful. So you can peak. By January 2013, you can peak, but it's still, you still have time to get it going. Okay, so I'm urging everyone to get those fundamental life habits going. You know, the things that you say, you know what, I need to do this So just, you know, get it going, baby steps, and get it going. You don't have to jump into the pool, but just start, dip your toe in, and, you know, gradually get in a little bit more, a little bit more. I do a little bit more every day, a little bit more. Like I just did like 4 minutes on a stationary bike instead of two, you know. Just did some 50 jumping jacks instead of 25 this morning. Just various things, you just gradually increase. It's a natural thing, you just increase. And then I, you know, this morning said, let me just, you know, go on water for the next couple days and make the weight, you know. It's just an arbitrary thing, the weight, just arbitrary. But I said, you know, that's a nice number. Let's make that number. Let's do everything we can to make that number. So the election that's coming up. In politics, I'm officially neutral because it's irrelevant to the big picture. The big picture is you don't want to get a return ticket to this world. Okay. You want to disengage from belief. You want to be able to stand up to belief and say, belief, you know, you cannot bully me in any way. And I'm finished with you. Now, belief claims that we're incompetent, but it's really belief that's incompetent, you know, because belief can't reach its goal. And belief claims that because we don't give it enough attention, that's why it's not reaching its goal, and our attention is incompetent. So we're worried about our attention, our awareness being incompetent. It's not incompetent. It's belief that's incompetent, but it's actually not incompetent. It's insane. Difference, big difference. Because if a goal is impossible to reach, how can you be incompetent to reach it? To even bring up the term incompetence is insanity. So belief is entirely insane. And we need to keep disengaging from belief, keep standing up to it, and find better and better and better ways to stand up to it. So that when in the afterlife, when we, you know, transit into the afterlife, and in the afterlife, When belief, the habit of being bullied by belief, it's not something external. It comes from our long, long habit of being bullied by belief and wanting belief to be true. When that tells us that we have to return, and we say no, and that it ratchets up the pressure, and finally it, you know, drops the secret of secrets on us that tells us, guess what, I didn't want to tell you this, but you're actually the key player in this whole thing. And that you say, no, that's not true. There is no key player. Because there is no thing, there is no plan, there is nothing happening at all in existence, just insanity. How can there be a key player to accomplishing the impossible? How can there be a key player to accomplishing the impossible? So, the problem is with this election is the distraction. So it's super important to have to distract yourself from the distraction. Okay, sometimes it's called divine distraction, but we don't even have to go that far. You know, that would be helpful if that was here, but. If you can distract yourself from the distraction, for instance, this morning, you know, I don't look at the news. I have to try not to look at it, but I look at it maybe a little bit. This morning I was thinking, you know, let me click on the news, let me see what's going on. I said, no. Let me do my workout, let me get going here, let me do the taping. Stay away from the news because I have some other goals that are more important. So if you have habits and goals that are important, you can prevent yourself from being swept up into this massive distraction that is coming. And you know how the distraction works. We saw it in 2002. Is basically the election results in various states are legally challenged. And there's just a ferocious legal action enters onto the stage. And it becomes the prime player, and the whole thing is based on lawyers. You know, it gets into the whole lawyering thing, and they're going to decide the election. It could come down to that, and there's a lot more to it. It is a supreme distraction is coming up. Okay, we don't want to get caught up in that. That is one of the ultimate purposes of doing these videos, and you're watching them, is you're getting some positive encouragement to not get caught up in this black hole that's coming. And I'm hoping to, I would like to get to some place where the situation, the divine distraction starts its play, you know. That's my ultimate goal. I'm not there yet. You know, I feel these videos are pretty good. Have a lot of help and encouragement in them, but it certainly could be better. Could be better. And what's coming up now, we really need something even better. Divine distraction. That means we see the goal of being free of belief. And that is so attractive to us. We decide, you know, what do we need to do? You know, what to get that? I want that. And, you know, that's happened to me, both in glimpsing freedom from belief and in seeing some ambassadors of reality and truth here in the world and saying, ah, I want what they have, freedom from belief. Because this entire universe is just belief, arises from belief. It's the play of belief. It's belief believing in belief and insisting that the key ingredient is our attention on it, and our attention is going to enable it to succeed, which is completely insane. So our attention is like being, you know, held captive, like fixated, out of guilt, also out of desire to succeed, really. And guilt is just another weapon of belief, that the fixate attention and maintain this idea instead of choosing a new idea. And we want to be prime creator. We want to experience that idea. And so belief tells us this is the way to do it. And the key element is our attention has to remain on it. And we can't choose a new idea. And if we do, it's our failure. Somehow we failed. No, the idea cannot be experienced. So it can't be a question of failure, success or failure. That is insane. It's just unfulfilled desire there. There is no fulfillment of that idea. There's no way to experience that idea. There's always something that we're working on. And we can't even experience it now either. We can't experience in the past. We can't experience it now. We can't experience in the future. We can't experience it in time at all. So we have to choose a new idea, a new causal agent, which gives us a different effect, which is immediately experienced. And we've gone over and over that 1,000 times. And we will continue 1,000 more times. But I want to put this whole situation we're in going into context here about your situation. You need distraction from the black hole of distraction that is coming up. And let's face it, whatever outcome comes about, whoever gets power in their hands is going to want to consolidate that power to the utmost, recognizing that it's so fragile, okay, so fragile, and basically they will take drastic steps to do that, and for all intents and purposes, the game is over as far as this cycle goes. It's over. And it's just a train wreck is just, you know, taking place in front of us. And you need to be distracted from this train wreck. I mean, the United States is a train wreck. And, you know, it's probably going to commit suicide in a few days, really. And we don't need to watch this train wreck. We don't need to be focused on it. We, you know, there can be a distant awareness of it. I remember that dream I had where I was swimming in this calm bay, and way out in the distance I saw all the open ocean and how the white caps were, you know, whipping the ocean. It was very stormy out there, but in this calm bay, glassy, peaceful, smooth, no turbulence, you know. It's like that. If you want to look far out in the distance, you can say, yeah, there's all this turmoil going on. But where you are, oh, it's very peaceful. divine distraction. That is the goal. That is our goal. We want to be distracted by divinity, by reality, by perfect inclusiveness, by oneness, by that which cannot be threatened, which cannot be harmed in any way, that which is endless, that which is invulnerable, that which is delightful, that which is peaceful, that which is flawless, seamless, perfect, unshakable, that which is true, that which is sane. We want to be distracted by that as a goal. We want to say, oh, that's a goal. Let us, fixate on that goal. And sure, we can look off in the distance and see all the turmoil. Not a problem. But where we're at, where we're going, it's calm, it's peaceful. So that's super important now, because in the open ocean, the turmoil will be extreme. It will be extreme. I would probably say it's going to be the worst it's ever been on this planet. The turmoil this planet is headed into is going to be the worst turmoil ever. And even those who can believe themselves to be on a spiritual or on a spiritual path, etc., they're even at risk of getting swept up into this distraction of trying to straighten out the situation, straighten out belief. You can't straighten out belief. Belief is insane. You can't straighten out insanity. You can only choose sanity. Insanity is a denial of sanity. You can't straighten out a denial of insanity. It's inherently insane. You just have to let it go. You can't straighten it out. You can't straighten out the problems of the world. But you can choose a new world, as it were, a new experience, unconditional love, an overlay. And an overlay isn't worried about what it's overlaying. There's no need to straighten. It's not unconditional love doesn't come here to straighten anything out. It comes here to overlay everything. Completely different. So the problem with the world coming up is people are going to get swept up into trying to straighten things out, which pulls them into the black hole of belief even more drastically. And again, everybody in this world is potentially vulnerable to being swept up in that. Everybody. Even if you are quote-unquote enlightened at this point, you should not take it for granted that you're not going to get swept up in that. There's still the possibility is still there, because you may have a lot of people coming to see you for help, and they're going to be pulling you, saying, can you please straighten out, some of my life, what's going on? Can you? The real function of an ambassador of certainty is to give a goal of divine distraction. That's the real focus. That's the real purpose. Not to straighten anything out in the world. Not to straighten out insanity. Insanity will always be insane. Belief will always be insane. Belief will always be futile. It will always be flopping about. It's like a fish out of water. It's just, flopping around. You can't straighten that fish out on land to make it work properly. No, it's going to, that's not its element. You put the fish back in the water and the fish is fine, right? So belief is flopping all over the place like a fish out of water. And, it's all moving real crazily like this. And belief says, adapt to this. I need more tension here. I want to fix everything. No. You just put the fish back in the water. In other words, the fish out of water is the idea of trying to be prime creator, which is an impossible goal, can't be experienced, because you cannot change reality. It's set. So putting the fish back in the water is like choosing a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, and put that in unconditional love, overlaying all belief. There's no turmoil, there's certitude. Everything is completely smooth. So we need to be distracted by that fish that's in the water, not the one that's on land. Because, you know, how distracting is a fish out of water? It's very distracting, right? All these fish are flippity-floppity all over the place. And you're like, whoa, what's going on? It's very distracting. Awkwardness, chaos is very distracting. Anarchy, troubles, you know, like Superstorm Sandy, you know, very distracting. Because, gosh, you know, nothing's working right. Everything's, you know, out of whack. But again, other than pragmatic, practical, although pragmatic, practical level, of course you do what you need to do. But we're talking about getting our attention pulled into that and forgetting about what the true remedy is. You see, pragmatism, that doesn't mean you forget about the true remedy. You know, you get up and you do what you need to do to get through the day, but you don't lose sight of the goal. It's when you become fixated on process of outcome that, you know, that think it's going to lead to what you really want. That's when you're getting sucked into the black hole. The universe holds nothing that we really want. Belief holds nothing that we really want. So that flopping fish doesn't hold anything that we really want. It's awkward, you know. Put the fish back in the water, choose a new idea, and it's smooth. A lot of fish is just moving seamlessly, smoothly, right? So the ambassadors of certitude come into the world, and they're like that fish moving in the water. They're so smooth. They are so smooth. Effortlessly graceful. Effortlessly graceful. And we're distracted by that. We say, well, that's what I really want. I don't want to try and wrap my mind or my attention around this fish flopping around, you know, out of water. No, because it'll always be flopping. That's the fact. Belief will always be flip-flopping around. Always. That's what belief is. It's insanity. It's hypothetical plausibility. It's an attempt to accomplish the impossible, which has to be very awkward. You know, has to be very artificial. Awkward. Just doesn't feel right. Doesn't feel truly graceful at all. And, you know, our attempt to make it seem graceful is a waste of time. It's a waste of time. It is awkward. Existence is awkward. Always will be. It is fundamentally destructive also. It's torturous, actually. If you want to, you know, get down to the nitty-gritty, it is absolutely, it's traumatic. It's torturous. Very ungraceful and awkward. Feels artificial. Feels fake. Feels boring. Feels unsatisfying. All that, it'll always be that way. And as long as if we keep engaging and try to change it, we are getting sucked into that black hole of that trauma and suffering. Because it will have its way with us, because you can't change it. You cannot change it. But you can change the idea that gave rise to it. That you can change. And that is not awkward. But we need to be attracted to that goal. Because we're still trying to compromise, and it still feels awkward to us because we're trying to satisfy both belief and reality, truth. And we're still afraid that belief will bully us and claim that we're worthless and incompetent, which it will do. We're still a little worried about that. So we still try to incorporate some awkwardness into it. We try to do both. We try to get the fish back in the water and also try to fix the one that's on land. Trying to do both, that's crazy, that's insanity, that's futility, that causes us severe stress. And we end up, you know, just be feeling, you know, on the fence and not able to really function at all. So the situation that's coming up is like a fish out of water. The fish is going to start flopping. You know, sometimes you get the fish out of water and it flops a bit and then it goes quiet, right? And you say, finally the flopping stopped. It was driving me crazy, this fish, just all this uncoordinated flippy flopping around. The fish trying to swim in air, you know, just doesn't work for the fish. And then it stops and you say, okay, great. And your attention starts settling down and say, now I can, you know, get back to peace of mind. And then suddenly the fish starts quivering and then starts flipping, flopping all over the place. It's like, ah, you know, it's like, ah, it's terrible. It's like that. It's like the fish went kind of quiet for a while here in the world, a little bit of time. It kind of started quieting. And now it's been like shaking a little bit. And now it's going to start flipping and flopping like crazy. Like it's going to leap out of the basket, and we got in a basket or something, or, you know, it's just, we're like, whoa, get back in there, you know, calm down, and you won't be able to calm it down, forget it, fish is going nuts. So it's better to just turn your attention away from the fish in the air, in the basket, flip-flopping around, and put your attention on the fish that's in the water, swimming smoothly, calmly, you know, everything's calm there. Now, when there's a storm on the water, you know, the water gets ferociously choppy, you know, you can't see beneath the surface at all. What's beneath the surface? Calm. Calm is beneath the peace is beneath the surface. When the water surface is glassy and calm, you can see beneath the surface, much more easy to see, and you see the calm and the peace beneath the surface. But right now, what's going to happen is the winds are going to really be blowing, both physically and metaphorically, and the surface is going to get very, very, very choppy, stormy, very stormy. We just had a storm come in, right? Superstorm Sandy. That's an external representation of what is to come, and subtler levels of energy, of belief. But energy is just belief, okay? Reality doesn't run on energy, it runs on, it is essence. It's being and essence and isness. It's not energy. Energy is belief. The play of belief is what we call energy. So there's all sorts of quote-unquote, you know, subtler, all sorts of stratifications of energy. And so the more gross energy, sometimes it can play out externally, like we see the Superstorm Sandy, very, very gross, you know. And then there's subtler levels of energy play, and that's what's coming up. And it'll be a whole stratification of energy is gonna get in on the act. It's gonna be flip flopping all over the place, and it'll be very choppy. Like you look at a stormy ocean, you know, all the chop just chop. Like this, and you just like, you look at that, and your mind it just starts going. You know, if you look at a real choppy ocean, your mind just starts getting very confused, and you feel terrible. Whereas you look at something really glassy and serene, you know, you tend to feel this feeling like peace. You know, so the energy is going to get very choppy, very flip floppy, and everybody's going to be at each other's throats screaming, you know. And it's a worrisome thing. I've been monitoring the situation. There's still some civility left around the world, a little bit, mostly from those who grew up in a civil society. And those younger people who do not grown up in a civil society, I don't know if they even know what it is. They're even you may feel so upset or angry or something, you still speak out of from a position of love and respect and inclusiveness, and realizing that this whatever is happening on externally is not real anyway. So, you know, why express anger or upset? You know, keep it kind, loving kindness, even though you disagree, and you keep it calm, keep the surface calm at all times. Don't use inflammatory rhetoric or too polarizing, inflammatory. You can be adamant, you know, but be adamant in a kind way, kind body language, you know, etc. And people tend to be much more kindly in person, whereas on the internet, incivility tends to come out. And people have been raised on incivility now, rudeness and incivility, believing that there's nothing wrong with that. And if you look at some bulletin boards and forums, etc., from different countries around the world, it's a shocking eye opener. I mean, there is some tremendous hostility in certain places in the world, between India and Pakistan, for instance, it is really very bad. Between Israel and, you know, the other Middle East countries, is very bad. Between certain areas, it's very bad. Between in the United States, it's very bad. Between the progressives and the conservatives, extremely bad. So there's a lot of polarization in the world right now. And where civility is a casualty, and where civility is a casualty, the calmness, you know, it gets choppy, very choppy. And we've been going in that direction for a long time. And people who have, those who have come into this world, engaged with this world more recently, you know, that they've been surrounded by this atmosphere of resolution through attack, through, you know, rendering, tearing the other, the attacker to pieces, your adversary to pieces, attacking them, tearing them to pieces, and triumphing over them through whatever means necessary, and laughing about it, you know, like this is fine. It's shocking to older people. It's unbelievably shocking. I've been shocked, you know, probably hundreds of thousands of times, just horrified by what I've seen. You wouldn't see that in the past. If you did, you'd be absolutely horrified. And now it's simply seen as normal. So that is going to mean the ocean's going to get very choppy, because people will be engaging in what they feel is normal behavior for them, which will be actually extremely uncivil, or incivility, and tremendously aggressive posturing. And, you know, if you know history, you know what that leads to. For instance, in what used to be Bengal of India, it was partitioned into East and West Bengal, and there's a lot of incivility there, religious incivility. And then India and Pakistan were partitioned, and there was tremendous incivility there. I mean, you know, like in Lahore and in various places where there was a mixture of the Muslim and the Hindus, where they used to live together, you know, there was festering problems. And the excuse for incivility arose in the partitioning, and it was just unspeakable what occurred there, really. I won't even speak of it. It was so terrible. From people who used to live together, okay? And so that partitioning took place, and it was really horrible. And then there was Western and Eastern Pakistan, which was what used to be East Bengal, now was East Pakistan. And then the people of East Pakistan, what happened was Western Pakistan wanted the official language of East Pakistan to be what the language of West Pakistan was, and they tried to impose their culture from West Pakistan on East Pakistan, and the people of Eastern Pakistan said, no, we have our own language. So the language movement arose, and eventually it turned into a declaration of independence from West Pakistan, and that led to the War of Independence, where again there was incredible, unspeakable atrocities there. From carried out from a lot of it was from people who actually lived there, you know, carrying out on their own people, because they, you know, wanted to be loyal to Western Pakistan. So it was very, very terrible. That was just recent, you know, recent history, like, you know, 60, you know, well, that was like 40, you know, 1 years ago. That particular one, the partition of India was 75 years ago, or some 76, 77 years ago. You know, World War II, you know, was right after World War II, essentially. You have this incivility, you know, breaking out and then snowballing. Even in places where you thought, well, there's some civility. I mean, it's very surprising. But you have to look at how emotional people are. The emotionalism can easily overwhelm the veneer of civility. Okay, so I look at that. And satsang is extremely important, especially the kind that takes emotionalism out of the equation entirely. You have to be able to value clarity above emotion. There's no clarity in emotion, really. Emotion comes from belief. Okay. A belief is very emotional. And there's also a pseudo-intellectualism. The intellectualism also comes from belief, and it's belief's attempt to balance the emotionalism of belief. But intellectualism is a thin veneer. We say that civilization is a thin veneer. It's intellectualism that's a thin veneer. That we think it's all, we think we're sophisticated because we have intellectualism, which is taught, which is what the educational system teaches us, is intellectualism. Academia and intellectualism, and it's a completely thin veneer. And there's no, it is totally vulnerable to emotionalism. And we see that now. Like I say, United States is about ready to commit suicide, meaning it's going to go into emotionalism. Because the educational system that it's been using is simply, its goal is intellectualism, which is a completely thin veneer. It's putting your foundation on straw. You know, it's like building on the boardwalk in New Jersey, you know, right on the beach. What is that about? Of course there's going to be big storms, you know. And if you build your house on the sand, what do you think? What are you thinking? If you build your house in a flood zone, you know, well, there's going to be a flood come along. You know, you have people, like people in Bangladesh, they build their, you know, in the Sundarbans, they build their homes in the floodplain. So when a cyclone comes in, a big cyclone, of course, their houses are swept away. And they, you know, they think, oh, God hates us or something. No, come on. So when we put our faith in intellectualism, it was a disaster waiting to happen. We're building our homes on the boardwalk, on sand, on the beachfront. And you know, I saw that coming into this world, I saw that absolutely clearly and tried to change the situation, tried to get people divinely distracted into satsang, into clarity, beyond intellectualism. But the intellectuals they're really super emotional, actually. They're trying desperately to cover over the super emotionalism that they have and intellectuals become very rigid in their stances, you know, and very self-righteous, very stubborn. I can't move them, you know, because for them it's either this intellectualism or super emotionalism. And they think if you let go of intellectualism, they're going to have this super emotionalism. So what I've tried to do is, you know, speak in an intellectual way, but move towards clarity, towards knowing, towards intuitive recognition, through divine reason, seeing. And so you're not afraid to let go of intellectualism. It won't, you know, plunge you into emotionalism. You will abide in unconditional love, the perfect calm of that. So like when I was young and trying to help people, I tried to adapt intellectualism to try and be able to, you know, talk with them. And I became like a super intellectual to be able to try and, you know, help these people out who I said, look, you're headed for a disaster. And unfortunately, where we are at that disaster now, which is emotionalism is going to rule the day. And you know what happens when emotionalism starts running riot, it becomes a sense of collective hysteria, really what happens. And that plunges you into war, plunges into draconian laws, all sorts of incredible problems. To try and, you know, when you're out of control, hysteria, you will accept any sort of rule over you to calm you down. Really, You'll say, give us martial law, give us anything, just calm us down. You know, we're out of control. Or its clarity doesn't need any of that. Because it's not trying to straighten belief out. Its goal is to choose a new idea, and it's right on. It's focused on that, you know, laser focus on that. It's not bothered by whatever happens in this world. That, you know, it's not really a bother. It doesn't change the focus at all. What is shocking is to see a nation, a place of intellectualism, which seems to be civilized. I mean, Bangladesh, East Bengal, you know, it seemed to be civilized, you know. India, Pakistan seemed very civilized, very intellectual. They're very intellectual. And to see the stuff that happened there was, you know, wow, incredible. And to see now the emotionalism between India and Pakistan, for instance, is off the charts. It is off the charts. It is really hysteria. And to see that in a place that you know, I look at India is very intellectual, very sophisticated, but it's the veneer is thin. It's thin. And, you know, worldwide civilization is a thin veneer now, and it is ready to collapse. That veneer is ready to collapse and fragment. And there's going to be a severe dust up meaning conflict, turmoil. It is coming. But those who are distracted by divinity, by truth, they have real depth to their character, their situation, and they are not, you know, they keep it cool, they keep it calm in all circumstances. They're not pulled in by intellectualism. So when intellectualism collapses, they don't collapse, you know. They have another greater depth. They're familiar with a greater depth, which is divine reason, which is seeing, which is clarity, which is inquiry, which is true consideration, being able to recognize the insanity of belief. And they're used to examining the whole situation where it needs to be examined. They're used to vetting the entirety of belief. Belief itself is vetted. How does it arise? They're used to that, so they just keep on doing that, because they know that that's the resolution to all these problems. And they're not shaken up. And there are certainly people in Bangladesh and India and Pakistan who continued to do this. But the majority of people got swept up in emotionalism. And the United States, you know, supposed to be the bastion of civility and calm, etc., in the world, they are going to get swept up in emotionalism. Maybe at first they'll retreat into some severe intellectualism, but that is doesn't support you, doesn't support. It's like a shock when there's like a terrible train wreck. You go into shock, and you think, oh, everything's fine. I'm cool. I'm calm. I'm collected. And then when that protective mechanism wears off, then you just start shaking and trembling, and you can't control yourself, you know. So there may be a very reaction of sophisticated savoir-faire of I'm cool, I'm intellectual, nothing rattles me, etc. And that's superficial, and it's going to wear off. It's going to wear off because a lot of people don't have that, and they will start agitating, and eventually the agitation will reach the intellectuals, and they will start, you know, foaming at the mouth too, and saying, we need to impose order. And that'll, you know, things will unravel very quickly. The veneer of civilization will collapse very quickly, very soon. And divine distraction is, you know, the remedy for that. And, you know, there's not a lot of people in the world. If you're watching this video, you're one of the few. Who are really turning towards divine distraction and practicing, working out on these, this clarification, this seeing. This seeing is a workout. You know, it's not the seeing of the body's eyes. It's the seeing of awareness, of being, of isness, of spirit, of truth. It's that seeing. It's that which is seeing the trap that it's laid for itself. You know, how it's been deceiving itself, self-deception. It's that which is doing it. It's the willingness and the choice and the will to choose a new idea, the will to stand up to the bully of belief and say, no, I'm not a child of belief. You are my child, and you're not even a child. You're just a desire for a child that is separate from reality and is really nothing. The will to do that, you're one of the few that has the will to do that, and you have to continue that will forward, but there's going to be a dust up coming, and it'll catch the world by surprise, because we, to the extent we believe that intellectualism is stability, we will be very much surprised. It's not. Intellectuals are super emotional, and it's a defense mechanism to try and, you know, function with the super emotionalism that they have. And a desperate attempt to think, believe that they have a better belief or something, you know, that they're superior, you know. It's just a, you know, desperate to keep from falling into that pit of, you know, ferocity. But underneath, they're very ferocious. Maybe the most ferocious. I found that people that are just generally thuggish and brutal and stuff, that, you know, you can settle them down. But the intellectuals, it's not so easy to settle them down, their ferocity down. Once their ferocity gets going, it's very difficult, which is why, you know, the worst stuff in the world has happened when intellectuals slip down into their ferocity, emotionalism, and then they, you know, perpetrate, you know, incredible problems on the world, incredible dust-ups, because they refuse to acknowledge what they're doing. They say, no, I'm helping everyone. As they're slaughtering, carrying out genocide, they don't even see it. Whereas just run-of-the-mill, thuggish, you know, emotional people, you can say, hey, you know, stop it, knock it off, you know, this is the, what you're doing is bad, and they'll say, oh, okay, you know. The intellectuals say, who are you to tell me? I'm not doing anything bad. I'm carrying out some divine plan. You know, I've got the ideas that can solve the world's problems. I'm setting everything straight. I'm setting the world straight. You know, Pol Pot thought he was, you know, setting all the intellectuals straight in it was an intellectual trying to cure the intellectuals in Cambodia. So he said, hey, okay, all you intellectuals, we're all going out to the countryside, and we're going to all be peasants, and we're all going to work in the fields 16 hours a day. Evacuated all the cities. And sent all the intellectuals out into the fields, and of course they all died. You know, but who did that? It was an intellectual that did it. To the intellectuals. Intellectuals end up wiping themselves out, destroying themselves. That's like a perfect example of what happens. An intellectual says, hey, I got the cure for everybody. The cure is, you know, get back to pure emotionalism. This intellectualism isn't working. Go back to the fields, you know. Live on a cup of rice a day, you know. And these posh bourgeois intellectuals, you know, they couldn't handle it. Got sick, they died. Killing fields, you know. And then when they couldn't work, you know, they'd kill them off. And it was just absolutely insane. It was intellectual. That is the dead end of intellectualism, is the killing fields of Cambodia and Pol Pot. That is exactly what happens. Exactly what happens when intellectualism gets in charge. You are literally talking about annihilation. They'll annihilate themselves, which is why I have fought my entire life to try and, you know, get these intellectuals off of intellectualism. Say it's a dead end. You're going to annihilate yourselves and everybody else along with it. And You don't want the intellectuals in charge, believe me. You really don't. It is the most severe of dead ends, really is. Because they're they're so out of touch, you know, so out of touch, and in such severe denial. They're trying to force a remedy upon belief. They're trying to straighten belief out, which you cannot do. The more you try to straighten belief out, the more you destroy. Okay, you get into a destructive mode, and you don't realize the what happens is you use the end, you think, to justify the means. So you say, well, I have to destroy the village in order to save it. I have to wipe everything out in order to purify it. You know, you get into that mode and you can't snap out of it. You cannot snap out of it. You don't see. You can't see what's going on because you're caught up in the dynamic of belief and you think you're a savior. See, intellectuals think that they're saviors. They think they're going to save everybody. But in order to save everyone, they have to kill everyone. They have to lock down everyone. You know, put everyone in shackles. At best. And they don't see that's a problem at all. They just think that it's a price that needs to be paid, and those who are paying it, they need to pay that price. And they're the central planners, the elites, you know, they know how to straighten out belief. And it's just these steps they're taking are just the steps of straightening it out. So, you know, they commit genocide. They say, well, we're just straightening out these aspects of belief needed to be straightened out, and in the end it will all turn out to be totally justified. No, wrong. Insanity. So I'm not anti-intellectual, I'm pro-clarity. I'm pro the remedy for intellectualism is satsang, is inquiry, is clarity. That is the remedy. It is the remedy. So I'm not an intellectual at all. I can speak the intellectual's language, piece of cake, you know. I don't care who it is. Take the top intellectual in the world, I can speak their language, not a problem. But I'm not anti speaking that language. I'm pro going beyond that to moving them into clarity. And satsang, inquiry, clarification, contemplation. But you know, they have a superiority complex, which makes it very difficult for them to do this. And they'll only accept things as long as it's put in the context of their superiority. But what, again, is simply a defense mechanism of trying to control their own, you know, emotions of belief, the destructivity of belief. You cannot do it that way. You have to drop belief. You can't control belief. You have to drop it. You have to set it down. You have to let it. When you pick a new idea, belief doesn't even arise. You have to choose the non-arising of belief in the first place. That's the only remedy. Having belief arise and then trying to control it is insanity. And that leads to severe destructivity and trauma. Guaranteed. Educational system that's in place in the world is really very bad. Its goal is intellectualism, and really its goal is annihilation, is destructivity and trauma. That's what brings about it, and its goal is to avoid clarity. Absolutely. I went through the educational system. I said there's not a single shred of clarity here at all. I vetted the entire thing. So there's absolutely nothing here. It's only intellectualism, no clarity whatsoever. You're not taught to truly reason at all. You're taught materialistic cause and effect, not true causation, not to look at true causation. What gave rise to matter? What gave rise to material? What gave rise to energy? What gave rise to all of this? You're not taught to look at that. What gave rise to our reactions and emotions and thinking, thoughts and all that stuff. Where does all this come from? You know, what's the true origin? What's our true identity? All these things. You're not taught that at all. You're taught to ignore that. Taught to ignore it. So the educational system that has been in place in the world for a couple hundred years is simply teaching ignorance, validating ignorance by putting a song and dance, dressing it up. It's simply dressing up ignorance. That's all that it is. And then this getting pride in this ignorance. So intellectuals are super proud of their ignorance, super proud because they've gone through this whole process of just building in pride in their ignorance. That's all that they've done. And so when you talk to an intellectual, it's very difficult because they feel you're attacking their pride, you know. they say, nothing can be better than this. This is the best. I'm so proud of this. How can you? I want to put this on a pedestal. I want a better pedestal for this, you know, for this ignorance. Put the ignorance on the throne. And that is what the world is doing, is putting ignorance on a throne. And when you put ignorance on a throne and turn over, you know, the throne to ignorance, you know, you are simply asking for it. And it, you know, truth be told, it's uneducated people are actually way more intelligent than educated people. I know some people who never went to school, don't have any schooling. They're way more intelligent. They're more intelligent than me, even in practical matters. Really. It only goes so far. Okay. And it's not like they can truly get, you know, understand what's being said here in Satsang necessarily. I don't know exactly if they can or not, but probably not. Because they may see it, that they're able to use their greater intelligence to straighten things out better than the intellectuals. You know, that's usually what happens. But there's no doubt about it that those who have completely skipped the educational system in the world, and I know people very well who have done this. They grew up in extremely rural places where there was no education actually at all, hardly went any education, and had to work their whole lives, and they are super, super smart and aware and intelligent, way more than we are, to make us look like fools, really. I mean, they see stuff, and here we are, you know, carrying on our intellectual facade and stuff, and they must look at us like we're idiots, really. It's embarrassing. It's really embarrassing because they just see, you know, they see something falling on our heads and they just stop it. And I said, why didn't I see that? You know, why didn't I see that? Because, you know, we're caught up in the pride of intellectualism, and we're defending our pride that we know best, that we're intellectual. We know better, and we're trying to put it on a better pedestal. We're so involved in that, we don't see that everything is falling down on our heads. They see it. I've spoke with them about the situation. They actually see it more clearly than most of us see it. The problems that are coming, they just look and say, "Oh yeah, I can see that. No problem. Yeah, I know exactly what's going on," because they don't have any intellectualism. None. None. Imagine, don't even read or write. Don't read, don't write. No book learning, no schooling at all. Just working and surviving and making things function. Pure functionality. And so they can see the dysfunction in the world very clearly. It's amazing. It just shows you the blindness of intellectual pride, the extreme blindness of it, and you have the blind leading the blind, and this, you know, the more people who've gone through the whole schooling process, you know, I decided in seventh grade that I'd vetted the whole thing, and this is, that's it. You know, there's nothing here. This is terrible. I realized I was becoming. This was a process of stupidity, and I was way stupider than I used to be when I was younger. And the momentum of this schooling, intellectual schooling, led me into severe stupidity. But I was aware that it was a dumbing down process instead of a truly educational process. So I had to drop out of all that, paid no more attention to it. Just I'd take tests, you know, and just try to go on just intelligence, basic intelligence. What do they want me to say? And say it. But eventually, you know, it caught up to me where eventually I got to the point where I didn't even take the test, but teacher would hand out the test, and I just my name to it, a blank thing, and I just turned it in to the teacher, just blank. Just blank. I didn't even answer the questions. And because I was an accelerated program, you know, they try to determine, there's all these gifted programs, they try to determine who the real gifted people are and then mainline them, you know, into mainline intellectualisms, get them going in a fast track them, so they become super intellectuals. So I was in that program, and so even though I turned in a blank test, they couldn't really flunk me, you know, so they gave me a C-. And the teacher just basically, you know, just gave up and said, you know, we know you're really smart, but I don't know what's wrong with you. I'd say, hey, you know, this whole thing is completely bogus. It's leading to disaster. That's what's going on. And I got to drop out of this so I can be of help. If I keep playing this game, you know, I won't be of help when the help is really needed. When the bridge needs to be there, it will not be built. It's not easy to build a bridge from intellectualism to clarity, you know. It's not easy to build a bridge from trying to straighten out belief to setting belief down and choosing a new idea. It's not easy to do that. So I had to spend my time doing that. I can't spend my time, you know, playing this you know, game of tests and testing. Can't do it. I don't have time for that. And so they'd say, wow, how do I brighten this up? Okay. You know, how come you're not, you know, answering the questions? I said, I got to answer some real questions, okay? You know, I don't care how, you know, hydrogen and how that bonds with this and this and that, you know, forget it. I don't care about any of that stuff. You know, I care about how do we bridge from the collapse of civilization? How do we get to divine distraction? So, when I decided to take, you know, to do that, then I, you know, started coming across all these, you know, those who have done that before. And then I came across some heavyweights, you know, some true ambassadors of certitude, and have, you know, stayed with them ever since and worked on building that bridge. So intellectuals don't have to worry. I mean, if you've got the, you know, the PhD and the law degree and the medical degree and all these degrees, and you've read a trillion books and you've written trillion, you know, all these essays and blah, 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 you know, that's no problem for me. No problem whatsoever. You know, you have to be able, in today's world, you have to be able to help intellectuals, those who have all these, you know, who have played the game and have all this pride. You have to be able to help those. Because most, you know, most people are that way. And so, you know, I've done that. I mean, I've done an unbelievable amount of reading and written so many essays and et cetera, et cetera. But I just, you know, also would drop it all. I mean, I've written tons and tons of essays. And then I just say, okay, that's, and then set it aside and then delete it. And, you know, so what? So what? I've also made a ton of music and deleted most of it. Not all of it, but most of it. Made a lot of videos, and I've deleted a lot of videos, hundreds and hundreds, really. So I'm not, you know, I've read, you know, incredible number of books, and now I don't have, you know, don't have any books. I have A Course in Miracles, but I don't have any books. Not attached to any of that stuff, but I'm aware of all that and how to get unattached from it. You get unattached by seeing a better goal, by divine distraction, by saying, hey, I want to go across this bridge, because over here is chaos, over here is trauma, is destruction, is belief, is horrible stuff. And I want to get as far from that as possible. And so that's what's necessary right now. The intellectuals are in a bad, bad spot, really bad spot. You know, and there's these satsangs, you know. Again, I understand the whole picture, you know. It's not a judgment on intellectualism. That's just trying to straighten belief out, which cannot be done. You know, it's just simply trying to do the impossible. and trying to hang in there with that, which is what pride is. Pride is trying to keep doing, try to keep hanging in there, loyal to the effort to accomplish the impossible, believing that that loyalty will be the key. It's not. It's not. There's no way to do the impossible. There's no causation that can accomplish the impossible. There's no such thing. We can't change reality. So there's no causation that can change reality. We just end up with this unfulfilled desire, this idea that is unexperienced. And then we think, oh, that means all ideas are unexperienceable. No, it does not. The idea of trying to render all other ideas unexperienceable, has to be unexperienceable for all the other ideas to be experienceable. So the fact that it's unexperienceable means all other ideas are experienceable. You see? If we could change reality, there would be no reality. So the fact we can't change it means there is a reality, and it's there for us. So you have to look at it that way. So the importance is to be able to stop the intellectualism, the pride of intellectualism. That has to be just, the brakes have to be put on, and there has to be a shift out of that. And intellectuals go through a song and dance to do that. You know, they go through all this yoga, and you know, that's a slow boat to China. Okay, the retreats, these, this, and this, and that. Then you know, they're trying to bridge it. But at this point, you need divine distraction. This is what I see. All that slow boat to China stuff is okay, up to a point. But there's a certain point where, you know, it's kind of like you're walking. You know, let's say, how do we say this? Well, you can say it a lot of different ways. There's a pack of dogs, wild dogs, or, you know, and they see you, and they kind of, they're sort of trotting towards you. And you kind of, you're walking, you're looking back, and you say, you know, something, you know, is pursuing you. And, They keep going a little faster. You see the gap is closing, and you start to walk faster. You walk faster, a little faster. You know, you look back, and they're gaining on you. And so you start to, maybe you start jogging just a little bit, you know, a little jogging. You don't want to show any fear or anything. And you see that, you know, they're going closer and closer. The gap is closing. And you start, you know, running a little faster. And they're still closing. And then you start sprinting. Spreading as fast as you can. You look back and they're still closing on you. You know. And then you say, oh my gosh, I'm doomed. You know, I'm doomed. And then you look around and you realize that, you've run into a train station. And then something tells you, run up on the platform. So you run up on the platform. You look back and this pack of wild dogs, you know, are almost at your heels. And you say, oh my gosh, I'm going to die, it's terrible. And you look, and there's a train on the platform, and the door's open, and something tells you, get in that train. And you put on a burst of effort, and you jump in the train. When you do, the door closes, the train takes off. And the wild dogs are gnashing their teeth there. And you're just like shaking and trembling, like, oh my God, what happened? And the train takes off, and it's going through this beautiful, smooth, serene countryside, you know, and it's like someone's there with some food, you know, serving you, and there's some beautiful music and songs, and you just sit down, and you're just like, you know, what happened? It's incredible. And the train reaches somewhere, you disembark, you're in this like paradise, and you say, wow, you know, I made it. And it's like that. At some point, you got to jump on the train, you know, because you can't outrun intellectually. You cannot outrun what is coming. You cannot outrun it. Intellectually, you can't do it. You have to have something else. You have to have a train to jump into. And the door's closed, you know. And eventually, you have to shut out intellectuality. Eventually, you have to do that. Because intellectuality is trying to straighten out belief. And you can't do that. You cannot. That's what causes the trouble. That's what the trauma, the destructivity, you'll be completely engaged in that. And if you, you know, if you really have a super lot of pride in being intellectual, you'll end up chopping everyone to bits to save them, you know, because you believe that that's what's necessary to straighten out belief. Yeah, you'll end up fragmenting. The whole thing will fragment severely. And, you know, it seems as though that the people in this country, United States, have been so brainwashed by the educational system that they favor intellectualism, you know. And they think that's their salvation. It's really their damnation. And, you know, we've lost our pragmatism. Like I said, people I know have had no education. None. Are super pragmatic, you know. Very smart, very pragmatic. They'd make like very good business people. I mean, just they'd know how to just say, this is, you know, dealing with the pragmatism of the situation. They're not intellectuals at all. But, you know, the educational system of the United States and many all around the world actually has this insane faith in intellectualism. And so the more intellectual you are, the more faith they have in you. And that is a recipe for disaster. Recipe for severe fragmentation. And so that's the likelihood of that coming is very high, very high. I don't want it to turn out that way. But the fact is that our educational system is again, teaches pride in insanity, really. It teaches pride in what doesn't work. It teaches pride in the effort to try and accomplish the impossible instead of recognizing that you can never do it. And it mocks those who say, hey, it can't be done. It mocks them, really. Sarcasm. You know, intellectuals become very sarcastic. And they're human. They mock and are very sarcastic, and then they claim that this is humor. No, no, we're just being funny. We're just making jokes. No, they're not. They're being extremely mocking, because that is how insanity tries to mock reality and truth and sanity, and how it tries to keep attempting the impossible by mocking those who see it's impossible. Like, you're just weak. You know, you just don't have the intellect to do it. That's not true. You have the clarity to see it's impossible. Intellect is unable to see what's impossible, what is possible, and what's impossible. It can't see it. Because it is belief. Intellectualism is belief. It comes from belief. It comes from the premise that reality can be changed, and that's a false premise. I hear an alarm going off somewhere. Where's that coming from? It keeps going on and on and on. Beep, 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 beep. You can't hear it. It's very faint. Well, there should be alarm bells going off for you right now, because this is not a joke what's happening. The whole world has been caught up in this certain style of education, which was a drastic, drastic mistake. And it's belief that gave rise to all of this. And people lost their roots, have lost their roots in. Now, I mean, various alternatives to that are not without their flaws. Like religion is not without its flaws, that is for sure. It's got a ton of flaws. But it's not as bad as intellectualism. Intellectualism is even worse. The flaws of religion can be worked with in certain ways. Ultimately, that too has arisen from belief also. I would say, you know, it's like religion is like influenza, you know, like H1N1 or something. You know, it's like influenza. And intellectualism is like H5N1. It's like, you know, a killer influenza. It's kind of like that. You know, influenza is terrible, but you can get over it. H5N1, you know, so like the Spanish influenza was what was it? It was something H3N1 or something. But I mean, the bird flu now that we're worried about, H5N1, is really dangerous if it becomes transmissible. And they've actually, and the intellectual idiots have found a way to make it easily transmissible by making a couple key mutations. And, you know, they actually have the code of how to do this. And if that code gets out in the world and you get some other lunatic intellectuals in some other place who decide to actually manufacture this easily transmissible H5N1 and unleash this on the world, which they could very well do, you know, in Pakistan and India, I mean, the hostility they have there, I wouldn't put it past them of, like, you know, spreading it in the other country, you know, H5N1. It'd be easy for them to do that, wouldn't it? Very easy. And become super transmissible. You know, that's intellectualism doing that. That's not religion. Now, of course, the religious animosity, you know, arises, and that it's manageable. It's, you know, there are atrocities and there are problems, of course, yes, but it dies down quicker, and you can get back on track more easily. But when intellectualism arises as, you know, kind of a way to get rid of this religious instability, then it gets to the really bad, where we're at that point now, where you're able to literally genetically give rise to these super bugs that are transmissible, easily transmissible among humans, the H5N1. You're actually able to mutate it in the laboratory. You're able to control the weather, modify the weather, which they're doing. You're able to do things that are incredibly destructive. That comes from intellectualism. Religious people would never go in that direction. No way. Absolutely not. Because they're working on trying to straighten belief out in a different way. You know, through that is less destructive. It is like I say, it's still bad. It's still influenza, but it's not a mutated H5N1 influenza. That is really bad. And it's the intellectuals who do that. And it's not, they've already done it. It's just you haven't, you know, had it released, you know, very bad. And of course they've made all the, you know, nuclear weapons as well. And basically set up a hyper-destructive situation, which emotionalism, religious emotionalism, could never become that destructive. I mean, they can, you know, have wars and hack each other's heads off and stuff, and, you know, it calms down for another 100 years, 200 years, or whatever. I mean, India was invaded from the West by the Mughal Empire, what was set up, and you know, they were able to integrate and get along to a certain extent for hundreds of years, you know, and the Hindus and the Muslims kind of lived together for a long time, and, you know, managed to do it, and lots of great teachers arose in both traditions, and so, yeah, there were battles, there were wars of conquest and things like that. Yeah, that happens, absolutely it happens, but it settles down. And, you know, progress and clarity can still be taking place. But now we're in a different situation. We are in a totally different situation, where the intellectuals have gained control of the planet. And they're really able to destroy it. They're able to wipe everything out. They're able to fragment the whole situation of civilization through numerous means. You know, like I said, the H5N1 mutated and those type of superbugs released to the enemy territory, to the adversary's territory, then of course it spreads all over the world, and then you got quarantine. You get grounding of all air flights, all travel. If it breaks out like that in a certain place, you have a shutting down of all travel, okay? Martial law, you can't move. Your freedom of movement is boom, like that. You don't think that'll happen? It absolutely will happen. If a superbug is released, and I would say there's a high probability that's going to happen. The idiots, you know, publish the code online in the interest of finding out vaccines. Yeah, right. That's their you know, justification for it. They said, yeah, what if some bad guys figure it out and we don't have a vaccine for it, so we better publish this online, et cetera, et cetera. You know, it just gets out of control. And, you know, you've got a lot of people in the world who will do anything to wipe their enemies out. They don't care what it is. They're so fixated on that. They'll use germ warfare. They'll use it. But if you unleash a bug that's easily transmissible, then wherever that is, you know, you'll have to try and contain it, which means, you know, shutting down travel and having super, you know, the whole transportation thing of air flight now, if everyone has to go through scanners, everyone is getting used to being, you know, vetted, you know, can you go on a plane or not? In the future, it could very likely, the vetting process could become extremely intense, and actually only those who absolutely have to travel will be able to travel. That's very possible. And that's just a tiny tip of the iceberg of what's going to take place. You also have the situation with computers running the whole financial network of the planet and introducing bugs into those computers, okay? Which, again, there are those who are dedicated to doing that. You have a whole country of hackers. I mean, let's face it, China, you know, not necessarily the government, but rogue elements within the government, you know, trying to figure out how to hack the financial system of the planet, if necessary. Because obviously, you know, the central planners don't want to crash the world financial situation necessarily, because it could crash their own country, you know. But there could be elements within that situation that actually are working on a way to do it. And if that way to do it got in the wrong hands, you know, introduce the bugs into the computer systems of the world, you could crash it. Could be crashed very quickly. It's like the scientists, you know, mutating H5N1, making it easily transmissible. They don't necessarily want it to be used. But if it gets into the wrong hands, it could very well be used. So, you know, the hackers in China and various places, other countries around the world, who want to hack the United States computer systems, you know, the control, you know, all the atomic weapons that control the financial, international financial systems controlled by computers. If they figure out a way to hack all that and put a superbug into it, and you know, they may not want to use it. They may be saying, let's figure out what the weaknesses are, you know. So maybe we can figure out ways to prevent this, because maybe they're scared, you know. That gets in the wrong hands, it could very well be hacked. So you have that. And imagine the situation then. Financially, everyone would be on rationing, you know, coupons and rationing. Everyone would be assigned a number. I mean, you'd have a nightmare scenario. You'd have a black swan scenario. I mean, the black swan scenario is extremely likely on this planet now. And mean something that is so bad that it's unexpected, you know, and you don't plan for it. Well, you know, I've seen that coming from before I was even born here. That's why I came into this world, knowing that there will be black swan scenarios, or even worse than the black swanist can imagine, really. You know, in the prophecy, actually, in the Bible points out that the end times, all the affliction being poured out on the world, those are black swan events. And they say there's going to be one after the other, one vial after the other is poured out on the world. Severe afflictions. Collapsing civilization. And we, you know, and that will certainly distract everybody. Say, how do we straighten this all out? How do we straighten it out? Well, you can't straighten it out. you know, the intellectuals, of course, they'll say, we foresaw this and we know how to straighten this all out, and everybody's going to get a number and everybody's going to have a central database. We'll set up a central database, worldwide bureaucracy, running the entire world from a centralized bureaucracy with elite world planners in charge. So people say the Illuminati or something like that, but a lot of these central planners are extraterrestrial, as a matter of fact. And they have their partners, which we call the Illuminati, whatever, human partners. So it'll be a partnership between extraterrestrials and humans. And they will have a central planning bureaucracy running the entire planet. And that could be very, very close to taking place. But first, these black swan events will take place. That alarm is still running. Where is that coming from? You know, and the prophets have seen this. Those who are able to see in the future said, yeah, you know, this is coming. And so you have intellectuals in charge all over the world who are puppets of the Illuminati, the central planners, who in themselves are puppets of certain extraterrestrials who are experts in central planning and how to control the entire planet. That's why they're here. They're experts. They know these black swan events are going to take place. You might say that they have been working on trying to straighten out belief for a longer time than we have here. And so they've developed all sorts of tools that we're not familiar with, ways of doing it, trying to straighten out belief. In other words, putting a draconian control system over the entire planet. They have done that many times in the past, which ties in with the whole reptilian draconian thing, which they are experts in. Going to what they do is they go to planets, places where there are, where the intellectuals have brought up enough destructivity. So they try to straighten out belief, and in doing so, there's all these troubles and civilization collapses. And they foresee, they know it's coming. They come into a planet, and they begin to interface with the elites of the planet, the elite intellectuals, and they say, look, this stuff's going to happen. You got to, but we have the solution for it, and we look at what we can do. And they instigate, you know, high technology and the ability to use high technology in centralized databases, and ultimately, you know, cloud databases, so to speak, highly protected, to literally put severe controls over the entire planet, and everyone is numbered, everything they do is monitored, and they institute that draconian control over the planet. That's what the term draconian, you know, reptilian control. They've done that many, many, many places, many, many planets. So, you know, they're very well known. This is very well known throughout the galaxy, throughout the universe. And they're here now. They've been here. Absolutely, 100%. They've been here. And that's why all these reptilian themes started suddenly emerging on the planet. Like, people started, like, being just absolutely fixated on dinosaurs, you know. Reptilian dinosaurs. Even the post office would, you know, you go in the post office, all the postage stamps are all reptilian dinosaurs, you know, and they have all these big posters and everything. I mean, that was a while back. And the kids' cartoons have all these dinosaurs and reptilians in it, because they're getting people used to a reptilian presence. They're trying to have these nice talking dinosaurs, you know. Here's Barney, here's nice dinosaurs, are very nice, cuddly things, you know. And the kids want, oh, Mom, come out that dinosaur. Nice, you know, nice cuddly dinosaur, you know. They're very cuddly. So there's been a massive marketing campaign by the draconians. I call them draconians because they institute draconian rule. Draconian means extremely harsh and severe situations, laws, in order to give hyper-control, hyper-centralized control over an entire situation. You know, nothing is left unregulated and uncontrolled. And so they put on a marketing campaign. I've been aware of the entire situation here, how they've been marketed themselves. And now you see, you know, it's funny how they market themselves, because all these, you know, movies and stuff that you're seeing advertised have been for quite some time. You know, you see all these, they're all these reptilian vicious, you know, killers, reptilian winged creatures, and all these horrible dragons and reptilians, you know.
Who's behind that? The reptilians are behind that.
You see, why would they portray themselves that way too?
Well, they also have been portraying themselves as these cuddly, cute, cartoonish figures too. So what they're doing is they're saying that there are these terrible, warlike, horrible reptilians out there, but there's also these good reptilians, and the good reptilians are going to save us from these terrible reptilians who want to tear humanity to pieces. And the way to do it is to get this centralized draconian control over the whole planet. So, you know, they're very, very clever about that. You know, but these warlike draconians are part of a reptilian situation. They're like the stormtroopers, you know, but they say, you know, hey, if you don't go along with what we're doing, these stormtroopers will be unleashed upon you. And this is what they're going to do to you. Look at these movies, you know. You know, they're terrifying. So we've had all these movies and video games and pop culture of these terrifying, you know, T-Rex crunchers, you know, these just, you know, it's funny, you look on the internet and it seems like everybody's imagination is caught up in reptilian format of scaly, lizard-like, you know, a super powerful, you know, destructive entities that are able to, you know, wreak mayhem, you know. And so they say, hey, if you don't do this, this is what's going to happen to you. So, and then they present the cuddly side of the reptilians. We're really, you know, they say, hey, we're really very good, helpful people, you know, folks, you know. And then so the population, you know, goes along with it. And those who don't go along with it, everyone's been pre-programmed to switch into this, you know, bad reptilian mode, full-on mayhem mode, to those who don't want to go along with it, because they're somehow, you know, gumming up the works, you know, gumming up the works. So, you know, the goal is the New World Order, absolutely, run by the intellectuals. The intellectuals you see in this world are in power. You think we're the big shots. They're just pawns. They're just small fish who are several layers removed from the big fish. And they just have PR quality. Basically, if you got an intellectual who has PR charisma, then that's a very useful pawn to sway the masses. But behind them are the more of the central planners. There are a lot of councils and groups and foundations who have these more intellectuals who don't have much charisma at all. They're very dry, scaly kind of intellectualism. And then those societies and groups and foundations, etc., they tell the PR intellectuals who have movie star charisma, you know, how to sway the masses. And then behind those groups and foundations, etc., is another level of the more the big banking, the real higher elites of the planet, who are, you know, super intellectuals, who are very close to being almost reptilian themselves. And then they actually interface with certain extraterrestrials, and then there's sort of a crossover hybrid type that is sort of, you know, part human, part reptilian, who also have higher interfacing, and those are the ones who can be in the higher positions of power in the New World Order. And then above them are the elite draconians, who give them the orders about how to, you know, configure this planet. So the way that this planet is going to be has been planned for a long time. It's been set up for a long time. And this plan has been in implementation for quite some time now. And it's getting very close to the Black Swan events. But, you know, again, when you see through all this stuff, it's very easy to dismiss all of it. You dismiss the political, intellectual PR people. You dismiss the egghead, you know, foundation, secret society foundation intellectuals. You just dismiss the higher Illuminati bankers, etc. You dismiss them. You dismiss the reptilian human hybrids. You dismiss them. You dismiss the ET reptilians, draconians. You dismiss them. You dismiss all their hierarchy up to the very elite top of them. You dismiss all of them. You dismiss the entire universe and everything that arises in it, like it was nothing, like it was empty air. not a trouble at all. You dismiss belief itself, because all of this is arising as belief. It is simply belief arising as belief, and believing in it, that it has some ultimate viability. It's going to become real at some point. Belief never becomes real. So for me, dismissing all of this is nothing. It's like dismissing nothing. What kind of effort do you need to dismiss nothing? Eventually, we'll see it. I'll see it, you'll see it, we'll all see that. You don't need any effort to dismiss nothing. Yeah, we still think we need at least some. I still believe I need some effort, you know. And I know my mom knew takes no effort to dismiss nothing, so she was effortless. You know, her clarity was effortless, because she knew it doesn't require any effort to dismiss nothing. The dismissal of nothing, it is no effort. It's effortless. So that is the bridge we need to get in that position, because if we don't, you will be intimidated. You'll feel some intimidation through this whole draconian top-down thing, from the highest levels of draconian down through their many hierarchies. They have their very hierarchical civilization, and down through the hybrids here on this planet now, through genetic alteration and mind consciousness, mind techniques they use. They're able to develop hybrids that telepathically interact with them, with their higher elites. They have all sorts of psychic and telepathic abilities, and then they interact with the higher intellectuals, Illuminati and bankers, etc. And then that filters down to the societies and foundations they have. That filters down to the political leaders, and that filters down to their lawyers and their operatives, and then they impose through legal sanctions and the high tech people, and that all goes down into controlling you and me on the most minute level, all of that. You dismiss. That's intimidating for most of us. Now, it's still, probably a tiny bit intimidating for me, a little tiny bit there, sure, but it's not very intimidating, which is why I'm talking about it. But for most who haven't worked at this nonstop their whole lives, it feels a bit intimidating, So it's helpful to have those who are not intimidated by this. You can see it. You just see it. And you just say, "Huh, they're not so intimidated by it. I wonder, how is that possible?" And of course, many of you don't want to have this whole draconian system. You don't want to be part of that type of civilization, because you want freedom. There won't be no freedom in this. The only freedom you have is perks, and the only way you get perks is you be loyal to the system. So there's a lot of sycophants who, are desperate for their perks, who are gung-ho about this whole thing, and they're with the program. And, great many people are with the program. And this election will show that. That so many are so intimidated, they say, "Look, there's no way I can get free of this, so I might as well." That old fight, that cigarette company, what was it? Winston, or there's some cigarette company. I'd rather, if you can't beat them, switch, that kind of thing. Like, I couldn't win the fight, so I switch brands, switch to this brand. So if you feel like you can't beat, get free of this draconian system that's coming, and you're intimidated by it, you're going to switch over to it and say, "Okay, how can I get along, adjust, and get some perks out of it?" Which then, the trial runs in this world, in China and the Soviet Union, various trial runs. Those who tried to get the perks turned into informants, the lowest level informants, and then the higher, you'd have informants within the home, within families. Higher level, you'd have on each block would have an informant, where those who heard their parents say something that was not loyal to the plan, central planners, what the central planners wanted, would inform the block operative. Okay, that block operative would have a area, like a community area that had many streets on it. They would go inform them. That area would have a town or city town informant, and they would go inform them. That town informant would have a locale operative that was in charge of various towns, a certain area with some certain number of towns under them. They would inform them that though that one which would have certain towns under them would have a larger, county-wide, would have a statewide thing. It's kind of like here we have the house address, the street, the subdivision, the town, the county, the region, the state, and then the central federal government. It's like that, but they'd have it broken down all the way down to the family level. You'd inform them, the information, the data would make its way up that chain of command. And at some point in that chain of command, there is a part of that chain of command which is in charge of punishment and implementation, and we get turned over to them, and then those are the jackbooted, in Germany the SS and all that, kind of stuff. Those would be in charge of then remedial measures of seeing that everyone compliance, okay, division, compliance division, and you get turned over to compliance division at some level, and then that would work its way down through the various levels of compliance, where eventually those parents, where that child said the parents complained about how difficult it is to, how the old ways are better, I wish we would be free of all this control. Those parents who made that statement, the child overheard them, eventually those parents go, compliance gets a hold of them, and they're sent to re-education camps, is what happens. And the state is in charge of, raising the children at that point, because God forbid that the children might be raised by parents who might love freedom, So those were trial runs in China and Soviet Union and various places around the world. The draconians actually used that in Germany too. Germany was a trial run, definitely. The German intellectual elite were actually in contact with extraterrestrials. And it was a trial run by these extraterrestrials of how to implement this. It was very clumsy, very clumsy, because they didn't have the high tech we have now. But absolutely, they were in contact with certain extraterrestrial groups that have underground installations in the Himalayas and various places of Central Asia. We might wonder, where are the extraterrestrials? We don't see them walking around in boots and stuff. Well, if you want to see weird people walking around, go up to San Francisco or Berkeley or something. Okay, you'll see plenty of people walking around looking like ETs, but they're not. The ETs generally set up underground throughout history. They've been on this planet. There've always been ETs on this planet, and they're more now than ever. But they are able to, their technology is able to set up underground. They have vast underground areas, and so you don't see them above ground hardly at all. Occasionally, in order to contact some intellectuals and government officials of the chain, they will contact certain people. They might meet face to face. Some of the times in the past, people would say, "Well, I met the masters, spiritual masters," because they're wowed by the technology they have. And the spiritual masters say, yes, we're guiding humanity, the progress of humanity. And we have certain ones that we contact, and they have contacts within governments. And there's a whole chain of how the information of what they want done gets done. But for the most part, they don't walk among us very often. They can look similar to us for sure if they want to. They have technology to do that. But so they're underground. And the Nazis were in contact with these extraterrestrials, and they were under the influence of them, very much so. And the educational systems that the Prussians had set up, prior to that, also had been guided by the extraterrestrials here as a means to start implementing the Black Swan events and the whole chain of command, of draconian chain of command, start getting that in place. Also implementing a situation where the whole civilization collapses because the intellectuals have developed all these ways to destroy the planet, etc., which gives the pretext to invite in the draconians to set up this new world government, because they cannot do it unless we invite them, ask them to do so, because they have some treaties with other extraterrestrial races where they have agreed not to take over any planets unless they're asked to help out, that they can't come in and force their way, as it were. Because if they did that, it would be breaking these treaties that they have, and then they would be in big trouble from these other extraterrestrials. And the universe is a nut house. It's an insane asylum, believe me. Belief is an insane asylum. You don't have to believe me, you can know it. Just look at it, just be aware. Anyway, there are these treaties. There have been some severe conflicts and wars between various extraterrestrial races that resulted in destruction of planets, etc. And in order to keep the peace, there are certain agreements. And one of the agreements is, you don't intervene, as it were. You have to be asked in a planet. They have to be petitioned. Say, hey, can you help us? Can you come help us? So they're very clever, the draconians, and what they've done is we said, can you help us in our education? They said, sure, we can help. So they set up this educational system that now the whole world's running on, this educational system. That educational system, though, has then given rise to this pride and intellectualism, and it's given rise, and we asked, can you help with our technology? They said, sure. So all this stuff, we asked to be helped, and we've been helped by them. They have their ways, channels of getting this information into us. Absolutely do. And now these black swan events are going to happen, and the world's going to be plunged into chaos. And what's going to happen is that we're going to ask them, can you please help us straighten this all out? And they're going to say, sure, we can. And that's when we will agree to let them be in charge. And they have their whole hierarchy thing, the whole governing hierarchy is already set up and ready to go. And the ability to, again, have the central servers, data, vast databases, server farms, where all the data to regulate everyone on the planet will be housed, and cloud computing will be able to access all their operators, be able to access this data in every single level, so that literally compliance officers will be able to come to your home, and they will be able to have every last bit of data on everything you've done, down to the minutest level, and have a complete readout for you, and they'll show you, and they'll be able to say, look, here's exactly what you've done, we know this is what you've done, and therefore you are compliance level such and such, and therefore you need to go to this and this re-education place. There are different re-education centers depending on your compliance problems that you have. Just like we have, we have county jail, we have work farms, juvenile hall, work farms, county jail. Then we have, prison, state prisons, various securities, various levels of security up to the highest maximum security state prison. Then we have federal prisons, and we have all sorts of levels of federal prisons up to the highest maximum security federal prisons. The same thing, they have re-education camps, have all different levels of severity depending on your compliance, level of compliance with what they want. That's the planet that we're headed to, and we're almost there, and this election will most likely seal the deal on that. And when the black swan events happen, we will say, hey, please help us out. Do you have a governing system? Do you have a way to fix this? Whoever has a way to fix it, please help us. And the draconians will say, of course we do. But the price we pay, is our freedom. And what we don't realize is all these black swan events are intentionally orchestrated to give a pretext to give the draconians control. Why? Because they want control of this planet. It's very important strategically for them. They're under a truce with these other extraterrestrial civilizations, yes. But it's just a truce. It is not a permanent settlement. Belief is always having truces, but there's nothing permanent in belief. froze up there. And so they want this planet. They want to, this planet, super important to them, super important to rule this planet, have all their technology, all their weapon systems, all their slaves here, all the natural resources here. All this stuff is super important for the Draconians, super important. And their allies, they have allies too. There's a whole alliance, a Draconian alliance, as it were. And so they absolutely want to be in control of this planet. But they can't do it without breaking the truce that they've had, the peace agreements. That, you know, they have to be invited. Invited. And of course, the other extraterrestrials have been desperately trying to get us to not invite them here. And so they've given all sorts of teachings, etc., to try and avoid inviting them here. But their teachings are not true freedom at all, which is, I say, faux spirituality, because it's still within, it's still belief, it's still belief-based, it's just belief-based. And they have their own setup based on, you know, a different kind of way of how belief can accomplish the impossible. They have a different perspective on it. So, see, belief is always in conflict. The attempt to accomplish the impossible is always in conflict. There's this way they think can happen, and this way they think they can happen, and these two. And then, in order to hide the fact that it's impossible, you have these two different ways, and you make them in conflict with the other, you know, as if one way is preventing the other way from succeeding. And then you have these fights and wars and truces, and more fights and wars and truces, and it goes on and on like that. That obscures the truth that it's impossible. There is no way. And simply setting down belief. So the true gurus, the true ambassadors of certitude and reality are the heavyweights. They're beyond the universe. They're beyond these silly battles between various strategies to accomplish the impossible. No, they're beyond. It's a different spirituality. Their teaching is very different. But whereas you have a lot of those who are trying to prevent the Draconians from taking over this planet, they've been pumping out all sorts of spirituality, supposedly, to prevent this. But it's not a real truth at all. It's just, so it's a waste of our time. But because they want to rule this planet themselves. So they're trying to say that their way is better than the Draconians. And it on the surface, it does seem better. But it is a waste of time also. It's a waste of time also, because it's develop your psychic powers, you know, develop your healing powers, develop your you know, they paint a picture of freedom for you, which is faux freedom. It's not real freedom at all. It's spirituality. It's not freedom. It's not reality. It's spirituality. The spiritual path is to bring you back to reality, not to spirituality. So there's a lot of ETs and their allies who believe in spirituality as the key. You know, all this love and light, spirituality, they believe that's the way that belief can succeed. And then the Draconians say, no, that's all BS. No, the way to succeed is control. Everyone has to be on the same page and everything has to be super controlled. That's the way that belief can succeed. The others say, no, spirituality is the way it can succeed. They're both equally insane, equally mistaken, actually. So I don't take sides between the Draconians and the other alliance, call it whatever you want to. I don't, because I see them as equally mistaken. You know, I don't want either. I don't want either. That's a fact. So you might, people wonder, you know, how come you're not, you know, you don't hate the Draconians or something, you know, and you're not aligning yourself with the spirituality. No, both of them are equally mistaken, and I'm willing to speak to either one of them, you know, and show that, you know, the real path. I don't say that the Draconians are evil and the love and light and peace spirituality are good. I don't say that. They're both insane, equally insane. They're both engaged, equally engaged with insanity. They're not really insane, you know. They're equally engaged with insanity, and neither one of them sees it, because they both want their way. They think is the way to succeed in getting a way to force the Prime Creator to change reality and make us Spirit Prime Creator. So they're both Spirit, one with what I am. Spirit, we're all one. But they're equally engaged with insanity. Spirituality and control are just two sides of the same coin. Two sides of the same coin. So it's not like I have hatred towards, you know, either side, but I dismiss both of them equally. You know, just I definitely dismiss their rhetoric and their engagement with their belief. They're engaging with that. Dismiss it equally. So a lot of people are deceived in one direction, a lot of people are deceived in the other direction. I dismiss both those directions, two sides of one coin of self-deception. And able to say this because I have genuine teachers, like Ananda Mayama, Jesus Christ, Ramana Maharshi. They see through the entire cosmic deception. Entire cosmic deception. Easily. And, you know, they're sane. They're completely sane. They're not insane. And I know saying that one's completely sane is a you know, double statement, right? Because sanity has to be complete, or it's not sanity. But as far as insanity goes, there is a situation where we can start gravitating away from that. You know, insanity is also completely insane. But what we are, spirit, when we're wanting insanity to be sane, we can gravitate away from that wanting, that desire. So you can talk about desire, you can say some of us are less desirous that insanity be true than others, you know, we've gravitated further than others, whereas the ambassadors of certainty gravitating towards away from that desire is no longer an issue. They have zero desire of trying to change reality, none, and we're not yet at that point, but we can get there, and we have to get there. Drop desire entirely, like the Buddha dropped desire entirely. No desire whatsoever, completely free of desire, because all desire is for the impossible to happen, because everything else happens instantly. Whatever we want happens instantly there, so there's no space for desire to arise at all. So you can't absolutely be free. It doesn't mean you don't have any experiencing. It means your experiencing is infinitely rich and endlessly expanding. So it's wonderful. You know, para nirvana, the great nirvana. It's beyond nirvana even. Nirvana is like getting used to no desire, and then para nirvana is where even the getting used to is completely unnecessary. Because you've literally chosen a new idea. And it's now, you've even gone beyond that, and you're now chosen an idea beyond the idea of not wanting to change reality. You're now fully in the oneness, the flow of reality. That's like para nirvana. But our goal is to choose a new idea and get used to that overlay, abide in that overlay and get used to it and gravitate towards choosing a new idea. That is our goal, and we have to do that eventually. Now's a great time. And now what's going to happen coming up? Well, of course the draconians want to rule this planet, absolutely, and they're the ones in charge at this point. They have their other people in place. Their technology is in place. Everything's in place. Those who the spiritualists, who believe in spirituality, they may offer refuge from the draconians in some way. There may be an evacuation of the planet at some point. It's possible. There may be refuge. You may offer refuge in other planets, other places. They have the means of transport. Absolutely do. Some extraterrestrials are very, very sophisticated and advanced in transport beyond space and time. In hyperspace. They function in hyperspace, as it were. So absolutely they can do that. And you can go to a place that's very into spirituality. There are a lot of those on this planet who that's their goal. That's what they're going to do. In my case, I'm not interested in that. I'm not interested in going to a place that's in a spirituality place, a spiritual planet, as it were. No. You might call that the fourth dimension. Like the draconians want like a third dimensional planet, want to be in charge of it. The spirituality people want a fourth dimensional situation, a spiritual planet, as it were. Those who realize both those are two sides of one coin of self-illusion, they want what's called, you might call it fifth dimension, which is different. It's like a paradise. It's different, very different, where there's no harm to anything. Nothing can be traumatized. It's like it's a different situation. It's effortless. Having some bandwidth problems here. Hopefully it'll keep going. So you might say the difference between third, fourth, and fifth dimensions. You know, it's just figures of speech, really. So you might say that the fifth dimension is actually a refuge from both the third and the fourth dimension. It's a refuge from the draconian high-tech control matrix. It's a refuge from the psychic spirituality, spiritual planet matrix. It's a refuge from both of those. That's what I want. That's where I'm going. However that works out, I don't know exactly how it's going to work out. So that's the lay of the land. That's the lay of the land going forward. We have the election, we have the Black Swan events, we have turmoil, chaos, we have the Draconians instituting their New World Order, and you probably will have extraterrestrials will probably come out of the closet at some point soon. And you'll be aware of the airships, the ships, and those are probably the spiritualists who are going to evacuate many off this planet, because there are even more black swan events coming, very severe black swan events coming on this planet that are geophysical and cosmic, right? A lot of bad stuff. So I expect that more and more UFOs are going to start showing up in the sky, and people videotaping them, and the world is going to get very used to the fact that there are these transport ships. And at some point, you know, people will be evacuated. A lot of people evacuate from this planet. That's coming up, and then those are, you know, fourth dimensional. Then in some way, the fifth dimensional, those who are going to the fifth dimension will somehow be. How they will find themselves there is some kind of, you know, some way. I'm not exactly sure how to describe it. But that will take place too. And that may not even involve transport, physical transport at all, you know. Probably will not. That you can probably just sit with a perfect guru of certainty, master of certainty, and you can sit with them and you can literally find yourself simply there. Beyond belief. There beyond belief. All of this is coming. You know, those spiritualists have been saying for decades that the airships are going to show up. You know, they haven't yet. So many predictions that our space brothers, those are spiritual, our space brothers are going to show themselves, and there'll be a mass sighting, you know, over cities and everything. The evacuation is going to take place. Well, it hasn't happened yet, but it's very likely it will soon. The space brothers, who are equally deluded to the reptilians, really, the draconians, equally deluded. It doesn't mean they don't have spaceships. Of course they have spaceships. It doesn't mean they have don't have spiritual planets. Of course they have spiritual planets. Or spirituality-based planets. Of course they do. Of course they have all the crystal stuff and, you know, all this stuff. Of course they have all that stuff. Sure. They have advanced spaceships. They have all that stuff. Doesn't mean anything. You know? We can, take an airplane and then take a helicopter and drop down into the Amazon to some people who have never seen anything outside of their own tribe ever. We can do that. And they see us. Does that mean we're super advanced? You know, they look at us, they think like we're gods. You know, how are we doing this? Does that mean they don't have any of this technology? We do. Does that mean we're super advanced? Of course not, because we're going to basically destroy the planet pretty soon. So we're not. Just because you have technology doesn't mean you're advanced in wisdom at all. Doesn't mean anything. It doesn't mean you're enlightened at all. No, it does not. So of course there'll be ways. There are planets and dwelling places and spiritual planet, you know, spirituality based planets. Just as there's the high tech draconian based planets too. Absolutely. There are ways to go there. Of course. It's no big deal at all to see this. Just like if you drop down Amazon jungle and you took some of these tribal people who've never seen an outside person in their whole, you know, ever in their whole history. You put them in a helicopter, take them back to where your small airplane is, take that small airplane to a larger airport, get in the larger airport, take a, you know, jumbo jet and drop them into New York City, you know. You could do that. They'd like me. Oh, you know, like, you know, whoa, I'm in some, like, totally other world. You know, this I'm in the world of the gods. You know, and of course, if you, you know, were in New York City or San Francisco or else, you know, you'd know that's hardly the case, right? You know, you being sophisticated, you'd know limitations of sophistication. You know, you'd say, gods, are you kidding? We're all messed up. But they would be, you know, looking at all these buildings, you know, and subways and infrastructure and things and the stores and clothing and everything. Your eyes would be like, you know, like this. You know, you blow their minds completely, right? They'd think that they've gone to the land of the gods. And the way they were transported there, they think, well, the transport of the gods is unbelievably, you know, completely miraculous for us. So what are you talking about, you know? Are you nuts? You know, why are you praising us as gods? Are you kidding? But of course they'd be that way. So of course there are those who have more sophisticated technology than we do. Of course they have this stuff and they have planets and all that. And of course they can transport us there. And they've been trying to actually get us ready for that transport. Now, if you want to transport an Amazonian tribes person who never seen anything outside of their area, and you want to transport them, you knew ahead of time you're transport them, you would start a program of getting them used to stuff. You might give them books, you know, you might give them education, you might give them movies, you know, television, and you'd show these programs to get them ready for where you're going to transport them to. So when they get there, they say, hey, that looks like the movie I was watching, that looked like the books I was reading, and there's some familiarity. So of course all this education, you know, the stuff that's going on in pop culture, etc., that is getting us ready for the next, you know, going somewhere. All the science fiction, all these stuff, you know, that comes from other planets, of way the other planets are. And, you know, people are heavily into sci-fi. They go to these other planets, they'll say, hey, this looks like the sci-fi stuff I was into. And the way people dress, people now are like dressing up in all these, you know, was it Comic-Con or something? That is just a way to get ready for what is to come. All the way that they dress up in all these cyborg, you know, steroid kind of muscular, weird costumes of cartoon characters, et cetera, et cetera. They're just getting ready to go to another planet or get with the program on this planet that is going to come in. All the genetic modifications, all the steroidal drugs that are used to build up all sorts of attributes so they can look more, you know, draconian, reptilian, you know, be into all these different signals of attraction. You know, they have different ways of attracting one another, all these, you know, by how they look, and they're, you know, we have to take steroids to get these various stuff, and, you know, and genetic modification. That there people are going to these places, conventions, and dressing that way, getting ready for it. Just like some people, when poverty hits, they before it happens, they dress up in shabby chic, you know, peasant dress, peasant chic. You know, no, they're getting themselves, wrapping their minds around the fact that they may be poor and destitute and homeless, homeless chic, you know, rags, dressing up in tattered clothing and rags and all this stuff, to say, hey, this is normal for me, no big deal. So whatever it is, the norm that we think, you know, what we think we're going towards, we try to normalize it for ourselves ahead of time. So which is why this, you know, this culture, world culture, is so bizarre, because it doesn't really fit in with the way the world has been in the past at all. Nor does it fit in with a regular progression of what you think the world will become. Something's wrong here. Maybe. Is it 2 hours already? Maybe. Okay. It doesn't fit in. So you know the way that people are trying to normalize themselves and stuff, that there's going to be some really abrupt, there's going to be some severe changes or something. People are going to go to different planets. And this planet here is going to be unrecognizable. You know, it's going to change drastically the way things are here. And everybody's trying to get with it so they get the perks, you know. Don't get sent to re-education camps. There's re-education camps on the spirituality planets too, because if you don't fit in there, they're going to send you to their version of re-education camps where you learn to be, you know, more spiritual. Absolutely. Whereas here on this planet, if you're real spiritual, the draconians will send you to re-education camps because you need to get with their program of hierarchical control, you know, high-tech control. And of course, if you're not interested in either one of those, they don't know what to do with you. Maybe it's off with your head at that point, you know. So, sure. I mean, they have, oh boy, you know, they've got all the genetic modification stuff going that you know, and all the nanotechnology, microtechnology of how to put in all this artificial stuff and control it with computers, etc. It goes on and on and on. They have all this kind of technology to literally build a race that is completely conformist to the central hierarchical ideologies of how to straighten out belief. We've got to straighten belief out, you know. They say, we've got to figure out a way to keep that fish from flip-flopping all over the place and get it straightened out, make it function smoothly, you know, so it's not conflicted, it's not devouring itself ceaselessly. Good luck with that. It's impossible. That would literally mean you could separate cause and effect, which means you could destroy reality, because reality is based on cause and effect ideas and their purpose, the effects serving those ideas, experience, based on experiencing. But experiencing is based on cause and effect. So you cannot straighten belief out. Belief is what it is. It's the belief that there is a way to destroy reality, and that's impossible. So it's the belief in the impossible. That's what it is. So you can't straighten that out. You can't change it. You can't straighten it out. You can try to delude yourself into thinking it's something else, but it's not. So that's why you keep getting hit with this trauma over and over and over, because you keep thinking it's something else, and it turns out it's not. The draconians think we got it all under control, and suddenly the spiritualists come in and they start messing everything up, and the draconians say, ah, it's totally traumatic. And the spiritualists think they got their sacred planets all set up, and the draconians come in and take them over, and they say, ah, how that happened? I thought we had it everything fine. It goes on and on and on like that, on and on and on. You have times when you think that belief is something else, and then you find out that it's very nasty. Continuously happens that way. So it's better to reckon, just accept belief as it is. Don't try to change it. Don't try to straighten it out. When you're willing to see it that way, then you can set it down. You can exchange it for what you really want. Different causal agent, which would result in what we call, you know, a fifth dimensional situation, paradise realm, where actually in that realm, there's no evidence of harm to anything, ever, because there's no desire to change what is. So there doesn't need to be any evidence of anything being changed at all. So you can have a tree there, and the tree you can feel as if the tree is infinitely old. It's been there forever, timeless. Everything there feels timeless. and has never been affected by, you know, any threat or harm whatsoever. It's completely timeless. That is the option. Absolutely is a great option. It's the option I'm going to choose. I've been aiming for that. And this isn't set in stone as far as how to explain it. But this gives you the lay of the land, general outline. And, the spiritualists are just as hard to reach as the intellectuals. Just as hard to reach. They have total pride in their supposed solution, how to straighten out belief. They have absolute pride in that too. And, they have all their spiritual technology that they're going to use. Just like the Draconians have all their high-tech stuff that they're going to, their way of straightening out belief is going to work. The spiritualists have all their spiritual technology. They say this is going to work. All their, love and light stuff and hold hands and prayer and work with consciousness and on and on and on and on and on. They have all their stuff too. But it's all exactly the same. It's all futile. It's all still trying to straighten out belief. Or they call it consciousness, whatever you want to call it, depends. But it's belief. Trying to straighten out belief. Trying to straighten out the content. If the only one is consciousness, trying to straighten out the content of consciousness. as if consciousness, can't be what it is unless you straighten out the content of it or something, But no, it's belief. It's belief. Is the awareness and consciousness that we believe is awareness and consciousness is just belief. It's not true awareness. It's not true experiencing at all. It's belief. And we think we can straighten that out, get that straightened out. Those are the spiritualists. So I don't draw any distinction between the spiritualists and the draconians. The high-tech people are the same. They're the same. Two sides of one coin. Both trying to, when I say they're the same, they're both trying to accomplish the same goal, which is impossible. So they're both trying to accomplish the impossible. It's just the means differ. Different means. They're trying to use different means. Who cares? It's like dressing a skeleton up, in different clothing. Put a dress on one skeleton and pants on another skeleton and say there's some difference. There's no difference. Still a skeleton. And, all these differentiations are meaningless. You have to see that. Draconians are usually said to be male-oriented. Patriotism, paternalism, or male-dominated. What is the word? Paternalism, or something like that. And the spiritualists are female-dominated. Okay, so when the spiritualists are talking to us, they're saying, the divine mother, the goddess, the female intuition, female knowing is superior to the male thing. What they're marketing is spirituality. Spirituality is what they're marketing. And where the Draconians are marketing is, we need to have the men, at the top, directing this because they know how to do this kind of stuff. And it's sort of a male-dominated society, supposedly, on the surface at least, but it's not actually quite that way. Actually, the females are still behind the scenes calling the shots, but it can be seen as a male, dominated hierarchy type of structure, whereas the spiritualists, it's a very much a female dominated situation, which is why you see like all the gurus and spiritual teachers of the world, I would say 75% of all those who come are female. Some more than that. It's like you have a token male here and there, but almost all female. The more spirituality-oriented it gets, the more female-oriented, because females are in charge of that spirituality planet. It's a female-dominated situation. And so they're here marketing that, to us. For me, they're both, I don't draw any distinction, they're both Nothing. They're both equally diluted. You know, a female-dominated spirituality planet or a male-dominated, draconian, high-tech-dominated control planet. Still, they're both trying to accomplish the impossible. Equally diluted. So I dismiss them both, you know, equally, without drawing any real meaningful distinction between them at all. The problem comes when you people start not being able to differentiate between truth, the teachings of truth, of certitude, and spirituality. And so, you know, you get, that's the problem. So I have to be able to differentiate that, because there's a tendency to try and think that they're the same thing. They're not at all. No, really, they don't meet at all. I'm not trying to put this into a spirituality context, because it's not true. None of that is true. Try to put it in a high-tech context, either one. Context of clarity. And from that standpoint, it doesn't matter whether it's male or female, that is not the point at all. It's the clarity that's important. I mean, Anandamayi is one of my central teachers, and said female, you know. I don't pay any attention to whether she's female or male. It doesn't even register. And I'm just looking at the clarity and the certitude, and the fact that belief can't bully her in the slightest bit, and spirituality could not bully her either in the slightest bit. Neither could the draconian control freaks bully her in the slightest bit. She wasn't bullied by males. She wasn't bullied by females. Both males and females tried to get her to support, you know, their situation. She didn't support either one. Said, no, you're both deluded. Okay, you got to get past that. You got to go to the realm where there is no death, death-free realm. You have to transcend this duality, you know. There is no way to accomplish the impossible. So it doesn't matter. Clarification doesn't matter. It's coming from, you know, male meat suit or a female meat suit. That doesn't matter. But what matters is is recognizing that spirituality isn't it. And that is a heavily female-dominated. It is extremely female-dominated right now, spirituality. Unbelievably so. It is completely, you know, there's no balance there whatsoever. No even pretext balance there. And so that's worth pointing out, you know, is you have to be aware of that, of spirituality, and that's not it either. And there's a tendency for spirituality to be very clever and play off the draconian thing and saying, you know, hey, look how bad this is here. We are the remedy for it. And you know, people say, oh my gosh, I don't want to live under these horrible reptilians. Okay, you must be it. And so you jump out of the frying pan into the fire, because their spirituality has its own control freakism, just as bad as draconian, a high-tech draconian central planning, just as bad. But it's got a velvet glove to it, you know. It's got makeup on it. It's prettier. Okay. But the control and the delusion and stuff is just as bad. And you might even say, because it's prettier, you might even say it's even worse, because at least the draconian, just see how ugly it is, how terrible, you know, whoa, horrible. Whereas real pretty, make it real pretty, put a bow on it, you know, you might think like, hey, this isn't so bad. It's just kind of pretty. You know, so it may even cause more delay. Possible. And so you got spirituality marketing itself here extremely aggressively. And it's, you know, even it's trying to get converts to its side. Because really, it's in a war with the draconians. Belief is in a war with itself. And each perspective is trying to overcome the other. It's in a truce, but it's also building up power to try and destroy the other. So spirituality is desperately marketing on this planet to try to get as many possible to go to its domain, its realm. Get with that, and the draconians are aggressively marketing, trying to get as many as possible to go under its control, too. But the way to do is reject both of that. Reject both of those equally. And that's what I do. That's why I speak out. And spirituality is marketing to those who might be interested in truth. Like, for instance, A Course in Miracles, there are those who use that to market spirituality and the whole goddess, feminine goddess setup of spirituality and those planets and etc. They sort of try to use A Course in Miracles and say, yeah, this is what we're really about, and move it in that direction towards spirituality. And, my inner guidance told me, don't have anything to do with that. Pay no attention. Absolutely, that is not for you at all. Okay, but that definitely happened. Definitely happened. Where it's saying, hey, A Course in Miracles is really pointing in this direction. This is what it wants. See here, look at the goddess. Look how beautiful. Look at the compassion, the beauty, how pretty it is. How loving, how kind, how feminine compassion, intuition, and loving kindness and inclusivity and all this, all this stuff. Look how wonderful that is. That's what it's pointing towards. So you don't really need to the Course that much, because here's what it's pointing towards. You can have that. So why don't you just grab hold of that? I said, no, that's not what it's pointing towards. And every legitimate teaching, you have these marketers of spirituality who insist that it's pointing to that, to spirituality, to this, female-dominated spirituality. And if you don't get that, you're going to get this male-dominated draconian hell, That's what they're scaring you with that. And I say, no. You drop both of those. Drop belief itself. And both of those are gone. They're both aspects of belief. They're just simply belief in conflict with itself, which it must be. They don't want either one of them. Dismiss both of them equally. They're both nothing. They're both completely futile. They're just different styles of futility. Drop them both. Reality isn't male or female. There's no such thing as male or female in reality. There's, male and female are just different styles of trying to accomplish the impossible. Reality doesn't have any style. It is. Isness doesn't have a gender or a style to it. All that stuff is just the nonsense of belief. So this is my pre-election, video, my effort here, getting ready for the election, spilling all the beans, even more so than before, if that's possible, pointing out, this is a heavier level of stuff, pointing out the spirituality and all this, feminism and the marketing of spirituality and marketing of feminine females and goddess and mother and blah, 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 blah. They even marketed Anandamayi as some kind of feminist goddess, mother, great mother, divine mother, who's pointing towards spirituality. They even marketed that very heavily. It's been marketed very heavily that way, which is absolute nonsense. She would have none of that. When she was here, she would have none of that. She didn't criticize. She was truly loving, so she knew how to deal with it in a truly loving way. But she would have none of it, really, at all. Now she said, no. I'm no mother. I'm nobody's mother. I'm just a little crazy little girl, is all. That's it. Maybe I'm your sister, but that's it. And she admonished him, don't see me as a mother or this goddess or mother, anything like that. No. I'm just a crazy little girl. Very adamant about that. Of course, people just dismiss that, and still the spirituality people, tried to market her as this, the goddess who's attracting you to spirituality. She said, this is what you're going to get when you go to spirituality and go to these feminine based, patriarchal planets. No, patriarchy, that's what I was trying to think. It's either, patriarchal planet or matriarchal matrix. Patriarchal matrix, matriarchal matrix. Try saying that three times fast. They say that's your choice. That's your choice. Completely false choice. That's like saying, do I want the car, black or white? Same car, same vehicle, same futility, same insanity. But, you know, what color do you want your insanity in? Do you want your insanity in a dress, or do you want your sanity in pants? That's the choice that they're laying out for us. Nanamayama, Ramana, Jesus, that's not the choice they laid out for us. They laid out the choice of freedom from belief. Freedom from futility. Re-engaging with reality. That's the option they laid out. Either truth or lies, they laid out. It's either one or the other. They laid out the true option. Whereas these others are laying out a false choice, false option, false hope. And, you know, the draconians have their ways of intimidating you, sarcasm and mocking and saying, you know, you're incompetent. And then the spiritualists have their way of trying to intimidate you, saying if you don't go along with that, well, you're a misogynist, you know, you're anti-female, you know, all this kind of stuff. You want male-dominated patriarchy. In other words, they give you a false option. Like, if you're not with them, you must be with the draconians. That's a false option. You can be with dropping both of them. It's got, you know, entirely different thing. So I don't like the paternal, I don't like the patriarchy option. I don't like the matriarchy option. In fact, both of them are equally distasteful. Now, the draconians themselves have conflicts among themselves about exactly how to go about it. And so they fight among themselves. So their situations were like, as the, you know, matriarchal spiritualists also have their conflicts, and they fight among themselves too. Just different styles of futility is all that it is. So, you know, hopefully, you know, this is reaching receptive ears, and you're at least, you know, saying having some aha moments, you know, aha moments. I'm super, super, I'm not, you know, you can call it, I critique. I don't hate any of this stuff, but I am very adamant in critiquing it. So, you know, I'll critique the patriarchy, absolutely, and just I'll say this is nothing you want. I'll critique the matriarchy and say this is absolutely nothing you want, equally, both. Both, you know, and that maybe that'll shock people, because, like, you know, they say, whoa, you know, people are used to having the patriarchy criticized, because that was part of the game the draconians were playing, to break the power structure on this planet, you know, which was male dominated, the power structure on the surface. It's actually underneath the females actually always call the shots, but on the surface, authority wise, male dominated. Because, like, you know, if the man goes home to the wife, if he doesn't do what the wife really wants him to do, you know, there's hell to pay. That's always been in play. Always will be in play. because the females have the eggs. They're the ones who keep producing these meat suits, you know, which is all important for belief. All important. Because they keep producing forms of vulnerability, which is key to belief's entire plan to accomplish the impossible. So belief does favor females. Absolutely does. Because they're more key, they're absolutely key, because they give birth to the form, you see. The forms of vulnerability, they give birth to it. So they actually do have the underlying power. But as far as functionality goes, you know, we can talk about a patriarchy, we can talk about that. I'm very critical of that, saying, you know, you don't, this isn't it. But I'm also very critical of the matriarchy and say, this is not it. You know, absolutely not it. And I'm also very critical of worshiping females. Absolutely. Because that's belief. Belief wants you to worship females because females give birth to forms of vulnerability, which are then traumatized. Dead ends. Basically give rise to forms of constant dead ends, dead-endness. And belief tells you, they have the answer. You know, that is the answer. You just have to put your attention on that more, and it'll work. You know, put your attention on the goddess, and that'll save you. No, it will not. It will just keep you within damnation and trauma and dead endness and death and suffering, confusion and despair and depression. It'll just keep you there. It'll fixate you on that. And the spirituality places are all about, you know, worshiping the goddess. You know, which is, you know, very, very delay-based situation. And I haven't, you know, used any names. You don't need to use names, because when you use names, you think if you just focus on that person, you got it, you know. He says, now I know who's doing that. Now I'm in control. No. Because there's endless pawns that arise, players that arise. You have to see the whole situation in the abstract, meaning not on a personal level, but on the total level of the dynamic, the total dynamic. So if you focus on names and people, you're going to get, you'll lose the potency of the clarity. That's why I try not to use names. You know, of course I know, I'm aware of those who have been marketing, you know, spirituality or marketing, matriarchal marketing or patriarchal marketing. Of course I'm aware of those who are doing that. Some, you know, there's a lot. It's a very intense marketing event. But, you know, pointing them out, trying to highlight them is actually a waste of time. You have to see the total situation as it is. It doesn't matter who is marketing, it's what is being marketed that's important, not who is marketing it. Who is marketing it? What meat suit is being used? What dress is being used doesn't matter. It's what is being marketed that matters. That is the focus. And Annamaya Ma would never criticize anyone. She never made it personal. She was amazing at that. Incredible. People would always ask her, what do you think about this so-and-so? And she said, nothing occurs to me to say in response to that. She would not personalize it, you know, unless she could say something very positive, but she wouldn't personalize it, because that really is a delaying thing. Because you think, if I just scapegoat that person, let's get rid of them, everything will be fine. Not true. Because the purpose remains. What is being marketed? And why is it being marketed? Find out that. And its belief, and its desire, and its the idea of wanting to be prime creator, that's giving rise to all this marketing, all these meat suits, all of it. As long as that stays intact, the marketing will continue. If you don't like one marketer, someone else will take their place. And belief just tells you, well, what don't you like about the marketer? You know, you don't like how they look, etc. Just tell us, you know. And you say, yeah, I don't like that marketer. Belief will say, okay. I'll get you. I'll bring in someone better. And you totally avoid looking at what is being marketed. And the fact is, it's what is being marketed that you don't like. Not the marketer. You know, the marketer, who cares who's marketing? It's what's being marketed that you don't like. Now, there are some marketers who are more skillful than others. That is true. And you may not like them, which is, you know, true, because they're very skilled at it. Yeah, of course. But still, in order to get the leverage, you have to have leverage over belief itself. Not over some super skillful marketer. Of course, there are some very skillful marketers in the world right now, which don't please me in the slightest bit, because I know they're leading a lot of people astray. But still, the way to deal with this is to get clarity on the big picture, on standing up to belief itself, not who's marketing belief. I can stand up to those skillful marketers, piece of cake. But you know, you have to be able to stand up to what is sending them, what is, you know, bringing about the marketing in the first place. What is behind it? It's belief. What is behind belief? Desire. What is behind desire? The idea of wanting to be prime creator. What is behind the desire? Who chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator? Spirit did. How do you remedy it? Where's the will to remedy it? With spirit. Spirit has to choose a new idea. The idea of not trying to be prime creator gives rise to no desire, which doesn't give rise to any belief, which doesn't give any rise of marketing belief, which doesn't give rise to any marketers of belief. What does it give rise to? Unconditional love, perfect overlay. It gives rise to marketers of unconditional love and overlay. And those marketers are wonderful, because I've met, you know, I've been aware of some of them. Hold on one second here. One second. Okay, I guess I have to get with the day. Yeah, I've said plenty here. Plenty, plenty, plenty. Pre-election package here I'm giving you. Pre-election satsang. There's a pre-election satsang where it just blows the cover off the entire thing, you know. And, you know, good satsang should blow your mind, absolutely, absolutely should. You just feel like, whoa. Just like good, great music should really blow your mind if you see some music that is really, really, really well done, you know, it's just like, wow. It just, that's incredible. It should blow your mind. It should make you think like, whoa, I think there's some stuff I need to consider here. Like a great music, say, how do they do that? How do they get that sound? You know, wow, that's amazing sound they're getting there. It's not normal, you know. Normally you don't get this great sound. How do they do that? Same thing. How do you get this clarity? How are you able to stand up to the bully of belief? How are you able to dismiss both the patriarchy and the matriarchy, dismiss the draconians and the spiritualists, you know, equally, just poof, just dismiss them? How is that possible? And then you start to say, well, it is possible. So how is it possible? And you start consideration, you know, you start inquiry, because you want it too. You want freedom. You really want freedom. You don't want to settle for enslavement, even if the enslavement is beautiful, right? Even if the face of enslavement is all made up, you don't want that either. You know, so, very good. Now I got to get on with the day in a little way. Maybe I'll be back later. This is the election special, man. This is the election special. Election special satsang. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.